Donnie Sutherland, welcome again to Sounds. Three very special guests you'll meet today are Kamal, plus two of the wildest pop people in this country, Ignatius Jones and Joylene Hairmouth. Also, later in the show, on a more serious note, we'll be saluting the late John Lennon in a half-hour special. I'll have with me rock historian Glenn A. Baker to retrace John's career. The big prize, valued at $6,500 that we've been waiting to give away for weeks, that lovely little Ford Escort GL, is to be won by some lucky viewer today. We'll also be drawing the winner later in the show out of a BMG, a blue metal and gravel specified concrete truck. Because there are that many entries, so be waiting for that. To each and every one, good luck to you. Here's our first double today, Shortly Split Ends, who are now back in Australia. We'll be working in Melbourne and Sydney this week. We'll play their song, One Step Ahead, right after we have a look at this one, Old 55, and it's their brand new single, Old 55, and Anywhere the Girls Are, We Will Go. This is off their current album, their brand new one called The Vault. Old 55, where are you? Old 55 were first with the track off The Vault and their brand new single, Anywhere the Girls Are. And that was, of course, Split Ends, who lobbed back into Australia earlier this week. They're in Melbourne tomorrow. They'll be in Sydney for a couple of dates. One has sold out, and I believe there's a second concert to go on, I think Wednesday. Tell you more about that a little later in our report. The Split Ends song, of course, One Step Ahead. Here's now one especially for our director upstairs, Kevin Burstall, who really, really can enjoy this lady at work. And there's a few others here on the floor that enjoy her too. Blondie and The Tide Is High. Come on, darling. Next, we have a mate of mine, a bloke who used to work on Great Keppel Island. In fact, he was in charge with his wife up there. Barry Schutz is his name. Doesn't spell it like that. He spells it like Schultz, but it's Schutz, the pronunciation. And if you've ever been to Great Keppel Island, say for the last few years, up until a couple of months ago, you would know Barry very well. He's the bloke that hands out those little certificates that say you got wrecked on Great Keppel. Top bloke. Prior to that, he'd won quite a few years running the award for Best Entertainer of the Year in Queensland. Now, he's got this single that he wrote 7 years ago. The Police are right behind him on this because it's all about a hitchhiker that gets a lift and then things go wrong. And it's called The Worst Way to Learn. In it, you'll also see, a little girl called Joanne Stanley, who will pop up next year on The Restless Years. Joanne, if you're watching on the Gold Coast, have a Merry Christmas, lovey. She's beautiful. Did you see her on page 3 last week in the paper? All right. She's the hitchhiker, I think. But this is Barry Schutz and his mates put together this song, The Worst Way to Learn. Barry Schutz and The Worst Way to Learn. A good message there for those people that do tend to hitchhike around this country. Got to watch yourself, eh? The Police, as I said, are right behind that. Good on you, Barry. A couple of friends. Lovely lady doing a verse in there, too. We'll find out her name in coming weeks. And, of course, the little lady that was doing the hitchhiking is Joanne Stanley, who's got a record around herself. And she's a lovely lady. In behind me, you can see the BMG truck. This is the blue metal and gravel specified cement truck that has been driven up from Jervis Bay by plant supervisor Craig Mitchell. Good on you, Craig. You can see him whacking in the last few entries there. We've had bags and bags of entries for Subbo's Wheel and the computer game throughout the year, and we've kept the lot. So if you've entered and you haven't won a prize on the computer and or Subbo's Wheel earlier in the year, don't worry, you've got a chance today to win a Ford Escort GL valued at $6,500, and we'll be giving it a spin. Even the entries we use today will go into the BMG specified cement truck, and Craig, of course, has got a very lovely assistant that we still have yet to see in the studio, but we will a little later on, and her name is Tanya Earl, who was recently in the Wollongong Queen Quest. Good on you, Tanya. They're helping out over there. Some other mentions very quickly. Cronulla Sutherland tomorrow night. Won't get to do this a little later, but if you can get along, it's been a rage for the last two. Will be a bigger rage tomorrow night, and you never know what can happen at Cronulla, so if you live in the area, get there. And Peter, our cameraman. Peter, our cameraman's a daddy. Remember last week I told you he wasn't yet a daddy? Look at the smile on his face from ear to ear. His wife Marissa and baby son are currently in Hornsby Hospital. All is well. Congratulations to all of you and good luck in the future. Last week on the show we had Ronnie Burns on. He's got a brand new single around, first one for quite a while. He's a vegetarian, Ronnie, and a very quiet man. We couldn't get him into any mischief. He just wanted to get back to the old motel, have a sleep, go and do his club last Saturday night and then head back to Melbourne. But he's a lovely bloke and a top talent in this country, as you well know. Let's have a look at the new one. Johnny Young wrote it for him, and it's called Brand New, number one.
Hello, it's Ian Grace here with The Sounds album review. First up, Harry Nilsson and Flash Harry.
Cheer up, Brian. You know what they say. Some things in life are bad. They can really make you mad.
A new one for the artistic Harry Nilsson, and again a fine group of musicians contribute to Flash Harry. The album features a special track sung by Eric Idle of Monty Python fame and Charlie Dore called Harry, and it makes a most interesting addition to a great album. On a similar note, Flash Harry contains Nilsson's own version of Eric Idle's Bright Side of Life.
Always look on the bright side of life.
Flash Harry by Harry Nilsson, available from PolyGram Records.
Always look on the light side of life.
Warren Zevon, Stand in the Fire.
I saw a werewolf, the Chinese menu in his head. Walking through the streets of Soho in the rain.
Stand in the Fire is Zevon's first live vinyl outing after recording three superb studio albums. The titles on Stand in the Fire read more like a best-of album, with tracks like Werewolves of London, Excitable Boy, and his original Poor, Poor, Pitiful Me. The live sound is excellent and proves that Zevon loses none of his eccentricity that he evokes when working to an audience and not merely a tape recorder. Stand in the Fire by Warren Zevon from WEA Records. Coast to Coast, the original motion picture soundtrack. A distinctively country-flavored album from the motion picture Coast to Coast, this package contains contributions from Johnny Lee, Jimmy Buffett, and J.D. Souther, to name a few. The film stars Robert Beretta Blake and the beautiful Diane Cannon. Of interest, 7 of the 10 songs are recorded exclusively for this soundtrack and are not available elsewhere, making Coast to Coast a rather rare country sampling. Coast to Coast from WEA Records. The new album for Fleetwood Mac, Fleetwood Mac Live. That's it for the Sounds album review. It's over to Donnie Sutherland for the singles review.
Tanya Gracie just picked up the old lounge here. Mate, this is getting very uncomfortable, but it's gone again. Ah, now for singles review, and it's got to be a quick one. Firstly, this one by a group who call themselves Aussie Band, and in fact, I believe they're two guys who actually worked as part of the road crew here with Fleetwood Mac when they toured this country. I don't know any more than that at this stage, but it's a good sound, and to those two guys who had the initiative to get up and have a go, good on you fellas. Single's called Somebody Wants You, and it's a good rocker. Hey, we've got to mention this one. The first lady of the Australian Rat Pack, Delilah. And a brand new release, I had a sneak preview of this one a couple of weeks ago, really is a new direction for Delilah and Butte. Single is called Sitting on the Edge of the Ocean, and if this isn't a hit, providing it gets airplay, I'll buy Delilah drinks for a month. And that could cost a fortune. The latest for the Cars is this single, Don't Tell Me No, from their Panorama album. It's a nice, powerful release and a pretty catchy thing too. Could be their first big hit since Let's Go. And this next single is probably going to be the biggest hit of all the Christmas releases for 1980. It's already been enormous in England. Will no doubt be the same here. The song is called Stop the Cavalry. The artist is Jonah Louie. It's released on the Stiff record label. You've probably already heard this Stop the Cavalry single, so you'll know exactly what I mean. A beauty, and we'll be a boomer. Right after this, next commercial, Sounds salutes John Lennon. The world this week mourned the death of John Lennon, legend and former Beatle member. A gunman has been charged with firing the bullets that killed Lennon. He doesn't deserve to be mentioned on this show. The thing that irks me is the continued rehashing of the facts of the murder days and days after John Lennon's death. To me, it appears to be becoming a blatant money-making vehicle by some of the world's media vultures, and looks like lingering on as long, if not longer, than the reports on Presley's death. I realize people everywhere are curious to know the facts of what happened to them. John on that fateful night, but is it necessary to rehash that story over and over, day after day? Do Lennon's relatives deserve to put up with it? I don't think so. Now that I've said that, let me explain. We are about to salute the late John Lennon in a half-hour special. Not to make money or win ratings, they finish for the year, and in some places you'll receive this story weeks after John's tragic death. The reason we're doing what we're doing is because, as a music show, we at Sound sincerely wish to salute one of the most influential writers and musos of our time. As my special guest, Glenn A. Baker, is here to tell us just a little more about the Disciple of Peace, and then we'll show some film, a lot of it not seen in the world before, and Glenn will tell us about that, on John as a solo performer and also as a member of the Beatles. Glenn A., thank you for coming in.
My pleasure.
And it is a rather serious thing, and it's been a tragic week, hasn't it?
It's been a very tragic week. I think it shook a lot of us up. Anyone who grew up with the Beatles and who had the Beatles as a part of their life, I think it was very, very shocked by the whole thing.
I think also there are a lot of kids probably out there that are like up to 16 years of age, anything under that, they may not have hardly known the Beatles, but they would have heard of the name and know of the music through their mums and dads.
Even so, even young kids, I think, are certainly aware of John Lennon. I don't think John Lennon really needs introduction to anyone, even at 12 years old. I mean, his impact, his influence, is just extraordinary.
I certainly know the name. Can we go back to, well, firstly, his real name and then how he got the Beatles?
Well, he was born John Winston Lennon, October 9, 1940, and he was raised by his aunt Mimi, dear old aunt Mimi. And on June the 15th, 1955, he met Paul at a sort of a garden church fete, and he was up on stage with what a band was probably at that time called the Quarrymen.
Yeah.
And it's important to note that in fact John and Paul were playing music together from the birth of rock and roll in 1955.
Mm.
They began writing songs together after school in each other's bedrooms, and in 1958 George joined the Quarrymen and he came into the group. In 1959 they played at the Casbah Club in Liverpool Open, and they played for 15 shillings a night. So they were, in fact, playing together a long, long time before the world heard of them. In August 1960, they made their first trip to Hamburg with Pete Best as the drummer, as the Silver Beatles, becoming sort of one step closer. And they were kicked out of Germany. George was too young, and he was deported, and the others were setting fire to wallpaper in a boarding room.
Always wild boys.
Always wild boys. Well, actually, in Germany, John got up to some really, really, really outrageous things. He used to wear toilet seats around his neck on stage, and once he did something from a balcony onto some nuns that was not considered to be in a good taste at all.
No.
And John was certainly a rowdy boy. In fact, in December 1960, they headlined at the Litherton Town Hall in Liverpool as one of the first gigs as the Beatles. And they'd come back from Hamburg, and that was really the beginning of them as the Beatles. And they began playing at the Cavern in 1961. And in April 1961, they did their first ever recording session in Hamburg with Tony Sheridan. And John sang Ain't She Sweet.
When did My Bonnie come?
That was where My Bonnie came from. It was their first ever recording session, arranged by the late Burt Camford. And on the 1st of January 1962, they auditioned for Decca in England and failed the audition.
Yes, right.
And it wasn't until 6 months later in June that they passed an audition at EMI with George Martin. And they were on their way. In August 1962, Ringo joined, and on August 23 in that year, John married Cynthia, who was pregnant with Julian at the time.
Right.
And I think then, I mean, it probably needs no telling. I mean, Love Me Do in November entered the chart. Beatlemania had begun.
What sort of crazy things did their fans get up to for those that are too young to remember those days?
Well, I mean, certainly wherever they went on tour, fans could climb 8 and 10 stories up sort of drainpipe gutterings, do anything like that. When they were in Holland, remember, in Amsterdam, they were on a barge in the canal. Canals in Amsterdam, and kids in the hundreds were just diving into the canal. I mean, in their clothes, and some of them were drowning. I mean, there was sort of nothing too outrageous in the Beatle days.
I read a book on them, and it said that John, at one time when they were at the Beatle Village, the cabin, was sleeping in a coffin. He was a rather weird boy.
Lennon had a macabre sense of humour that became very, very evident when the group... not macabre, but John was the perfect foil for Paul, and as much as he had a cynicism, he had a wit that was very sharp. He was often accused of being a cruel man, but I think that it wasn't cruelly so much as he just had a certain intolerance for fools. He didn't suffer fools gladly, as the line goes. Actually, one of the first points where we began to gather that John had this rather clever wit was in November 1963 at the Royal Command Performance Concert in London, where, before members of the royal family, he said, "On the next number, would those in the cheap seats clap their hands? The rest of you rattle your jewellery." and that was one of many lines. When in March 1964 he received the acclaimed Foyles Literary Prize for his book In His Own Right, he was obliged to get up and give a speech. He got up and he said, in fact, one line, thank you very much, you've got a lucky face. as the world's media waited for him to sort of, you know, to become ponderous and go on for an hour.
Exactly. He came out with one that got him into a bit of trouble the time that he spoke and said that on an interview that he thought the Beatles were bigger than Jesus. What happened
there? That was a really absurd situation. Well, early in 1966, in talking to his good friend Maureen Cleaver, the London Evening Standard, he said a line of which in parts read, "Christianity will go, it will vanish and shrink. I don't know what will go first, Christianity or rock and roll. In England, we are more popular than Jesus now." I think that most of us now can understand his sentiments. I don't think he was being particularly irreverent. But well, some months later, that was reprinted in a date book in America. And a DJ in Birmingham, Alabama, thought he could get into a bit of a cheap publicity and started a bonfire, and people were burning Beatle records and their promoters were cancelling shows. Brian Epstein had to come out and had to explain that, in fact, you know, that John was expressing a personal opinion to a close personal friend and that, you know, that he wasn't being irreverent. And John, in fact, had to apologise and retract it himself. But it was sort of a storm in a teacup. It didn't affect them. Shows a month later were still being sold out. But it was often, I mean, John loved to express exactly what he felt. When he was, in fact, it was announced that he was receiving an MBE in June 1965, he said, "I can't believe it. I thought you had to drive tanks and win wars to win an MBE.
Okay, now there was Flower Power, the Maharishi Mahesh Yogi and Yoko Ono he ran into, and that caused all sorts of trouble, and then they married, they had their split and back together again. Now, can we take it up to this week? The night of the shooting. Can you tell us much about that guy, that imbecile that shot him?
One of the things we've been able to gather so far is that the man had a Lennon fixation. He was signing his name John Lennon, he was pretending to be, and it would appear that he had sort of thought that he was the real John Lennon. There was a man in New York being an imposter. The only way that he could really be seen as Lennon was to wipe out the imposter. Yeah. I mean, the man is obviously very, very, very twisted. Yeah. And so he went there with the specific purpose of killing the one person that stood between him and being John Lennon.
How will it affect music in coming years?
I don't think that we can in any way underestimate John's effect as a songwriter. I think John's effect as a songwriter is probably more important. I remember specifically back when the Rubber Soul album came out in late 1965, where we really began to get an idea of what sort of talent the man had. While Paul was doing sweet and optimistic songs like Michelle, John was writing songs like A Norwegian Wood, which was about an affair that he wanted to keep a secret from Cynthia. Songs like Nowhere Man about alienation. It was just from that point on, he began to show that, you know, that he had enormous capacity for imagery in words. Even when it got to things like I Am the Walrus, with lines like, you know, yellow matter custard dripping from a dead dog's eye, which certainly horrified us, but we certainly remembered it.
Yeah.
And, you know, it shook us up a great deal. And, you know, to just think now that the man who was capable of just of opening our minds like that is now gone.
Let's look at now some footage, and some footage actually that you've given to us here on Sounds.
That's
is very rare, apparently not seen in most parts of the world.
Well, a lot of it is from my private collection and from other private collections. I'd like to actually thank John Comba from 2 Day FM and his father, who made some footage available to me. Some of it is taken from the Magical Mystery Tour film, others from the Japanese concert in 1966 in Tokyo, and there's some from their very first ever TV special around the Beatles, which features a very rare medley that was never repeated at any other point. A medley.
I believe you've got something this afternoon on 2JJ, 2JJ FM now these days, in Sydney at 3 p.m. You have the interview that was done with him, the last interview prior to his...
That's right, the BBC interview that was done, I think, last Saturday. And there's a rather tragic tale of the man who flew back to London and got off the plane and was told the news and said, "But I've just spoken to him."
Yeah.
How could that be? Actually, if we've got time, I'd just like to read one thing.
George Young.
That's right.
We could do it.
I spoke to George Young, of course, in the Vander and Young team, who knew John Lennon in England and when he was a member of the Easy Beats. And I did this for an American magazine, but it was, I think, just a nice tribute that I think is worth reading. George said, "In my opinion, Lennon was the only truly creative and innovative songwriter of the 60s. There was nobody else in his class. Lyrically, he widened the horizons of music time and time again. With so many songs, he opened doors that you felt you could walk through yourself. When I met him in England, he was an ordinary, down-to-earth guy, pretty much as I expected him to be. I felt very comfortable with him, and he obviously felt comfortable in the company of musicians. The saddest aspect of it all is that he became a victim of the sick world that he so often reflected in his music. Mm. He was in a position to observe the worst of human nature, and he constantly fought against it. He was one of the few people in our business who stood up and tried to do something about things that he knew were wrong. I really respect him for that."
Give peace a chance.
Indeed.
One from George, too.
That's right.
It's George Young from the Vander and Young team. Thank you, Glenn A.
My pleasure.
For being with us on this occasion as Sounds Now, for the next 20 minutes or so, salutes the late and great John Lennon. Now for a report, Rod Stewart will tour Australia in February. Rod will be more than likely supported on this tour by Swanee, who will have a new single out at that time. Despite rumours to the contrary, Rod hasn't cancelled his live tours for 81, but he has cut down on his American visits. He's coming to Aussie because he likes it. Police will tour Australia in January. They'll be supported by the Models and Mio 245, and the tour will be called Welcome to Zenyatta Mondatta. Tickets go on sale on December the 20th around Australia for that one. Here are Police, and don't stand so close to me. Watch closely, though, for tour dates around Australia. All right. There you go, Police coming to Australia in January. Kamal is back in Australia after a quick visit to Holland and England, and we'll find out about that trip in just a moment. Kamal has had huge success overseas in the past and is currently charting in Holland with an album and a single, both titled Save the Whale. His album in Australia, You Bring Out the Best, is doing very well at the moment, and his current single, Desiderata, also getting good airplay. We thought we'd be a little bit different this week, just a little bit different, and play this track off You Bring Out the Best called Miracles. Here is Kamal, and we'll talk to him about the album and his success overseas right after this. Kamal. You bet your sweet bippy it is. And that's one of the tracks off this You Bring Out the Best, the latest album for Kamal. And he's here with us on Sounds again today, and I thank you for flying up from Melbourne so early
in
the morning.
I better tell my family I'm here in Sydney. They don't know I've arrived.
Oh, they don't know you're back. All right. Sahodra.
Sahodra.
And
Raja, Rani, right. Yes. Yeah.
He's back. You know, let's talk about this album, because you recorded, what, 8 tracks overseas?
8 of those 35 tracks were recorded in London. Mm. As a matter of fact, we were doing a tribute to John Lennon. Mm. And the guitarist on that is McCartney's guitar player called Lawrence, doing all those lovely guitar fills in there.
Yeah, beautiful.
Yeah.
Inside, I noticed some photos that go back as far.
1959.
Can we get that one? That one there is 1959.
First television appearance.
And Kamal, there's another shot over there with Kamal on Bandstand. That's the one right in the High Diddle Diddle with Brian Henderson.
1969.
And then we go to this one down here.
Which 1980. That's 21 years.
You wouldn't, you look better these days than you did then. But only you
say the nicest
too.
Things.
Tell you that.
You say the nicest things.
The album overseas, Save the Whale, we haven't got that, have we?
No, I only recorded the Save the Whale on the 13th of November. Mm-hmm. It was released 15th.
Yeah.
It's number 17 in the charts now.
That's in Holland?
In Holland, yeah.
Now, you were invited over there by the Queen of Holland?
No, the Prince Bernhard.
The Prince of Holland?
Yeah, the husband of the Queen,
right.
The ex-Queen, yeah. To do this television special. As a matter of fact, early in the clip that did not go to all the other states, you put there was an artist on the show too, Randy Crawford.
Uh-huh.
Randy Crawford, Boney M., Meryl Mateur, Janis Ian, they were all on the same show.
That was lovely. And then you went across to England, you did Top of the Town.
No, did the Top of the Town first for 4 weeks.
All right.
And then
back
Holland.
To Holland. Uh-huh.
Went to New York, did a couple of tracks there for release in April of next year.
Talk of the Town's the one I want to worry about, because
yes.
You packed that out before. How did it go this time?
Fantastic. Yeah. You know, as you might have heard, show business in general in England is very bad at the moment. In fact, the worst in 41 years.
Really?
Yeah. But some of the shows are doing fairly well. But some shows have closed down. Sweeney Todd spent £2 million producing it, and it's gone off the market, you know.
Mm.
And it's kind of tragic. But
so the viewers went okay?
Yes, it's the talk of the town. It's a sort of a cabaret situation,
yeah.
And it's a tourist attraction. And because of my European success, we had a tremendous following. Yeah.
You're up from Melbourne today, this morning, as we've mentioned already.
Yeah.
And you go back there tonight, is it?
Or do No, I'm here for a few engagements till Saturday.
Right.
I go back on Sunday, and there is a very special show at the Palais Royal.
Which is tomorrow week.
Mm-hmm. To raise funds for the victims of the Italian earthquake. And there's going to be a whole array of artists, bands, the Australian Ballet, the Victorian Opera Company.
Do you know any of the solo acts that will be on with
you? Yeah, Shut Up Your Face is on.
Oh, Johnny.
Yes,
right.
He's going to be on.
Yeah.
And I think Johnny Farnham is going to be on too. But the ABC Show Band is going to play for us.
Right.
It's tremendous.
So we've spoken about that. Now, the last one I wanted to get to you, before you go, this is only days before Christmas.
Yes.
In some states when they take this. What are your thoughts for Christmas, and what would you want most for Christmas 1980?
I hope a peaceful 81. Yeah. That's our hope for it. I hope there will be no more of the killings of great writers and things like that. I hope there's some sort of sanity in life. From a personal point of view, to do my best a little sooner than later. No procrastination. I always keep putting things away. But I hope I can do what I feel I ought to do then and there rather than and not procrastinate. And also, when I found out that you and St. Ives, we have moved.
All right. So your hope is that I don't move to wherever you're now living.
To think that we were neighbors and only found out after I moved.
Mate, we could have had so many good parties, it's unreal.
I see.
Kamal, thank you for being on the show again.
Thank you
again,
very much.
Really, sincerely.
And
thank you
very happy Christmas and a brand new year for you.
To you likewise, and good luck with that album and the one that's going and the single overseas.
Thank you.
Kamal on Sounds, be back with something just a little bit different. Jimmy and the Boys. See you in a sec. I don't want any mischief, Joylene.
Donnie, don't look at me with such accusations.
Here now. And Ignatius. You have been outrageous in Sydney over the last couple of weeks. I hear. I haven't seen you in action the last few weeks.
Actually, I think you're going to see some action today.
Some action today.
Considering I've only had 1 hour of sleep, I
anything
feel
could
illegal, immoral, and I'm absolutely enjoying it.
Okay, you outrageous devil. Can we ask you both, I'll start with you, Jolene, the highlights of 1980 for Jimmy and the Boys. What do you see as the biggest highlight?
Well, I think it would have to be, for me personally, was being involved in my Senate campaign.
The political thing, right?
Which brings us on to a point we were discussing earlier, the formation of the Australian Cocktail Party and your future participation in it, Donnie.
Certainly, I...
Because you realise that everybody is invited to the Cocktail Party.
Well, I'm only too happy to be a member.
Well, if you ring us up on a phone number I'll give you after this interview.
Right.
Because to tell you it now would be just foolish madness on my part.
Yes.
I'll fix you up.
How did you go in your running?
Well, the tally was somewhere around 5,000 in the end.
And you were the most successful
independent
today.
Which is fantastic, considering it's the first time a transvestite has ever figured largely.
Yeah.
National electoral campaign. Very, very well.
Iggy, away from the political side for a tick, and with Jimmy and the Boys, your thoughts of as the highlight of 1980 for the group? You did the Smash, your sellout tour early in the year.
That's a really hard one, Donnie.
That was good. Perth was good.
That's a really hard one. I think Elton John telling me he was going to scratch my eyes out was great.
Oh, did he do that?
Yeah, I asked him about his transplant.
Right.
And he was, didn't take, did it?
You
scratch your eyes out.
Really?
Which is great, yeah.
You're currently making an album, aren't you?
Yeah.
Working on it at any time that you've got spare?
January. We'll be in the studio all of January.
Right. And who's the producer, the guy?
Danny Beckerman, an English guy, very new to Australia. Done a lot of work with Status Quo, Daltrey, orchestrated Journey to the Center of the Earth.
Yeah.
And
he
Tommy.
Worked on Tommy, yeah.
He's done a lot. He could be quite good.
A good man. He's already out here, right?
Yes. In fact, we've done two songs with him,
right.
Which turned out great.
Do you know where you're working tonight and over the Christmas break?
Well, the most important one, actually, is the Summer Madness Festival, 28th of December.
At Bangalore.
Which is near Byron Bay.
Exactly.
Yes.
Yep.
And Chuggy was telling me it's a family affair. The kids mums and dads,
free.
Everybody can get
the biggest
kids
event of the year in that area of Australia.
Yeah.
Right. And you'll be going up to that one.
That's, hands off from their road crew has bailed out of the you're going to pound for the day. Rose tattoo.
All sorts of the wild men.
Us and my sex. Should be great.
And wild ladies. I'm sorry, Joelene.
I'm glad to see you think I'm a lady, Donnie.
I certainly do. I ask you very quickly, because we've got the big Ford to draw shortly for $6,500, so we've got to get into that.
Oh, really?
What would you be giving Ignatius for Christmas, Julie?
That's a very hard question. I was thinking of a life-size effigy of Santa Claus, because he needs something new to chop up.
Oh, no, not on stage again. All right.
And no. This would be strictly in private.
Right. Ignatius, what would you give Julie?
A gold-plated Christy Allen dartboard.
Oh, that's just what I want.
We may have you back on the show a little later. I hope we can fit it in because we're running very short of time. Let's have a look at, I'm not like everybody else, and then products of your mind. Have you got one pet hate that you've had through 1980 as we go to that?
Stuart Coop. John Singleton.
Okay, products of your mind, and they're not like everybody else. Jimmy and the Boys. Thank you, Joylene, and thank you, Ignatius.
Thank you.
Jimmy and the Boys, Val Cooper is from Avis. Thank you, darling, for coming in again. And you'll help us draw. The noise you can hear in the background, and we might have a look at it, all the entries, bar the few that are still here for this week, or the few thousands, then we will whack in while the commercials are on. That's the BMG, specified concrete truck that has all the entries in it. It's going round, and very shortly, from the BMG truck, we will be selecting one lucky winner for a $6,500 Ford Escort GL. The man in charge of the truck is Craig Mitchell, and the lovely lady you see there with the lovely white pants on is Tanya Earle, whose father is a very big wheel in BMG. Good on you, Tanny. She finally got on the telly. Now, Val, we will draw very quickly.
Before you do, I've got a little
second last trick. Oh, thank you. From Avis.
Yes.
And they try harder. You bet your life on that. A little... Oh, what's it say? From the Avis Sponge. Oh, beaut. They try harder. Okay, in there, love. If we can have two. These are the second last two for the year because we stopped the old computer next week. Leanne...
Savory.
Very savory, right? Seven of Scott Street in Orbost, Victoria. Leanne will be spinning... will be pressing for you first. And your entry will, as soon as we're finished, get shoved into that truck, right? So you've no problems. You've got a chance for the car. Lisa Moretta, age 10. Must have started on number four. That's an oldie. That's,
yes.
She's forgotten that we've got the computer barrel, the board. Right. Oak Park. I don't know what I'm doing. I'm trying to speed. Victoria. So, Lisa Moretta, age 10, from Oak Park. You go second. And Leanne Savory. I don't think it is. I think it's Savory. Savoni. Of all Boston, Victoria. You're first. You'll get the first press. The boys are in already.
About this computer song.
Sorry, Sam Blues Brothers here,
sir. Oh, right. Well, tell us about it.
We've come along for the board.
Right. We're reorganise this a bit.
You now, take it or what?
No.
Gracie's got his eyes set
on the car.
On the car.
Yes,
right.
I want the $2,000 stereo system.
Seriously, where are your violin cases for a start?
Yeah. breakfast in there.
And my mum wants the cruise.
Well, listen, slip over there. Edge, leave me alone.
Nah.
Val, protect me.
Take yourself a free double pass to go and see the Blues Brothers move on.
Lovely.
Okay, chairman of the board. I'll see you later. See you, Val. I'd go with him if I were you. Don't stay here, though. Never know what. We're coming back very shortly to play with our computer. Alfred, he knows being played with. We'll be back.
Time now for the preferred attractions of what's going down around town. Russell Morris, Cyril B. Bunter and reporters rage tonight at the Sylvania Hotel, Prince's Highway. Wednesday, Gold Rush. Thursday, Radiators and Joe Joseph. Friday, Lonely Hearts. And next Saturday, The Models at the Sylvania Hotel. The Bexley North Hotel presents Vixen tonight. Monday, Joe Joseph plus the Radiators. Next Saturday, Mio 245 and reporters. Rock and roll at the Bexley North Hotel. Catch John Paul Young tonight at the Coleman Cutter Hotel, Blacktown. Wednesday, Joe Joseph plus Radiators. Thursday, Urban Rodeo Show. Friday, Models. Midnight Oiler at the Cutter Christmas Eve. The Family in Rydalmere present In Excess and the Motivators tonight. Tuesday, Cold Chisel. Friday, Joe Joseph plus the Radiators. And next Saturday, My Sex at the Family. Rock on tonight at the Fairfield Hotel to the numbers. Friday, Rupert B. Funkified. Next Saturday, The Sherbs. It's all happening at the Fairfield Hotel, right near the Fairfield Station. Sports. James Freud and PJ Hooker gig tonight at the Manly Vale Hotel in Condamine Street, Manly Vale. Friday, My Sex. Next Saturday, Joe Joseph plus the Radiators. Get down and boogie tonight at Jackson's Bar, 584 George Street, City. Drop in before or after the movies. Rage Thursday to Sunday, and there's an under-18s disco every Sunday, 1 through till 7 at Jackson's Bar opposite the Regent Theatre. Don't miss The Lonely Hearts every Thursday night at the Civic Hotel, Goulburn Street, City. Rock and roll at its very best, Thursday at the Civic. Crosthwaite's favourite band, The Lonely Hearts. Hey guys, beautiful Linda Ferguson, the penthouse pet, is Donnie Sutherland's very special guest tonight at the Duke of Earl in Homer Street, Elwood. You can meet Linda and win a copy of Penthouse at the Duke of Earl, Sydney's out-of-town in-place. Ida's Rock Village, Brougham Street, Woolloomooloo, feature James Freud and Berlin, plus PJ Hooker tonight. Next week, get along to the Sounds Christmas Party at the Rock Village, just off William Street. Boz Skaggs Hits is Harry Cohen's Record Bar Pick of the Week, available at Harry Cohen's Record Bar, Maroubra Junction. Harry's open Sunday till 1 p.m. If Harry hasn't got it, he'll get it.
Russell Morris and his Rubes are in Sydney at this moment. Nice to have you on. Thank you for helping yourself with Alfred. And we'll play for Leanne first. Russia at Marconi Club tonight, and where?
In Sylvania.
Two spots, eh?
Yeah.
Ash has done well for you. Just come over here and whack your little finger on that. Hold it for a while, mate. Second last time for the year. About now. The big one. Thank you. Right, Leanne, you've won yourself. I've read it that many times this year, I can nearly do it off by heart, I'll do it right. The major prize, the Sharp Entertainment Package, consisting of the Sharp Hi-Fi Stereo. What a nice way to end the year. A music centre valued at around $2,000 with 86 outstanding features, plus a Sharp 48-centimetre colour television valued at around $550. So that's $2,550 all up. In wood grain finish, total value of the Sharp prize, as I said, $2,500. Russell, and it's a pity for Sharp, we can't really lean on this because we're running short. We've got to draw that forward very shortly, but we'll give them a bit of time next week in their party. Name Bette Midler's latest movie, and she's in Sydney. Right, you got it right. No, he didn't.
What?
Do it again, real quick.
Divine Madness.
You got it. Right, me, fat Leanne. I thought she'd lost it for a while there. 7 years of age, from Warboston, Victoria. Who better to answer the question than Victorian man himself? Well, Russell Morris, you have a mate of yours from the Ribs. Could you introduce him, please? Maxie, your next go, bud.
All right, get old Alfred working here. Come on, Alfred, second last time of the year.
Sharp price can't go off. Put your hand on there, would you, Max?
I feel good.
Cruise. Cora Craft Jewelry. Not a bad one, though, for Lisa Maretta, age 10. Gosh, you're just a mum, Chrissy. Night-to-day collection of fashions you're in to suit your every mood. This prize comes to you from Cora Craft, valued at about $400, Lisa. If, Maxie, baby. Russell, you looked a bit like those other two blokes from the Blues.
Well, I don't think they're sending
me out. Yeah, I think they might have been. Finish off this song title. Very timely, too. Obla D. You got it, Max. Thank you. Lisa, you've got $400 worth of Coracraft, but Leanne Savoy of All Boston, Victoria, you've won $2,500 worth of beautiful Sharp gear. You'll see it all next week. We may still be able to fly you in for that last show of the year, the big Christmas show, the last live one, all right? The TAA will talk to them. You might be on the show next week. Okay, China, tell us about how you get on to Alfred, because we need entries coming over Christmas for next year.
If you'd like to be in the running for the big prizes from Alfred, write your name, age and address on the back of a standard-sized envelope. Send it to Alfred the Computer, Post Office Box 50, Epping, New South Wales, 2121.
That's it. It's so simple. Hush. Not a word to Mary. No, just hush. A revival of the old hit, eh?
Yeah.
And right. It's done wonders for you. Charting everywhere in Australia. Here they are. Russell Morris and the Rubes. Thank you, Max. This is it. This is it. The beautiful Ford Escort GL, valued at $6,500. Now, can we have a look at our BMG truck that is spinning the last of those entries? Whip them in as quick as you can there, will you, please? Tanya Earle from Wollongong is helping us there, and also Craig, who's up from Jarvis Bay with the truck. The entries are going in. They're getting that last final spin. This is the Ford that you can win. Now, we'd like to thank Ford very, very much for allowing us to have this one, and I think we should have a look just before we draw the winner from all the entries that have gone in for Southo's Wheel and Alfred and the computer board through 1980 for that car. Let's have a look at this car on the road, eh? The Ford Escort GL. It's a little trimmer. Ah.
Okay, how many entries to go? Just one more handful. In they go, Tanya. Tanya, sorry. And Craig, could you stop the BMG truck about... Come on, darling. About there. Could we please have our famous politician in? Joylene Thornbird, hair mouth. To draw?
Here I am.
You want to come in too, Iggy? Come over and be with us.
This one's for the $6,500 Ford that, as I just mentioned, they gave us to give away, and I think it's just unbelievable they've done so. Could you quickly whip those two off, Craig? I think we've got about 30 seconds to go on the show. We might not even draw it. Wouldn't it be awful if we didn't get to draw it?
This is wonderful. I've always been an escort girl, you know. And it's a real pleasure.
You are queen of pop.
No, I'm not, Donnie. I will be next
year. In our eyes, you are.
Several important and influential media people like you.
Actually, with the voting system, you know, to make it really all above board, you get the cocktail party in and they all throw in their votes and you've won, haven't you?
Donnie, it's that sort of comment which makes the cocktail party sound like a public.
Oh, no, I didn't mean it that way. But, you know, with all those people you've got in the cocktail party, if they're all right, sweep, you're home. So you're not only head of the cocktail party, but you're queen of pop.
Now,
1981.
Barrel girl.
Would
now,
you,
I'm going to dig deep.
Ding dong, Thornbird.
Finally, John.
This
Lord.
Is very I'm looking important. For an
do you want to get higher? Do you want to get higher?
No.
How many? That is full. That is full, you know. There must be about 300,000 or 400,000 or 500,000 letters in there. One lucky person.
The lucky winner.
Would
is
you read it, please?
Mrs. Narell Marriott, 4/4, Guildford.
Oh,
2161 Sydney. Age 19.
19 years of age, Narell. Listen, if you get up to Epping immediately and we'll take you down the Rubberty and buy you a drink too, and you can see your car, right? Guildford's only about 5-10 miles away. Come on up. Narell Marriott of 4/4, so she lives in a flat, probably on her own. I could marry this bird to sweet.
Donnie, she's broken promises again.
In Guildford, I'm sorry, Julie. Age 19, and she won at number 3, so that has been in for quite a while from Guildford. In fact, it came in February, second month of 1980, it came in for Southo's Wheel. That's how long ago you sent this in, Narell. I hope you're watching today. You probably thought, oh, well, that entry didn't win me anything, so I'll go out for the rest of the year. I hope you didn't, because if you're there now, you now know that you won $6,500 worth of Ford Escort GL. Thank you, Ford, and God bless you, Narell. What a nice little Christmas present. And that lovely lady that was on the board a little earlier gets $2,500 worth of Sharp in just a while, too. In fact, on next week's show. So that's our Christmas show. A good way to end the year. Come in here, mate. Thanks, Craig. Thank you, Tanya. Thank you to BMG, by the way, for sending this big truck up so that we could make it all fair dinkum. Here I am, with the head of the cocktail party.
Where's the spray fresh?
I'm a little bit woofy under the Warwick, aren't I? It's been a busy day. And Ignatius,
we
nice to have you on the show. Jimmy and the boys helped us draw this one. Again, congratulations, Narell Marriott. See you all around Australia next week, same time, same station. Been nice having you.